Living with uncertainty can take its toll. The normal day-to-day is replaced with fear, worry, doubt. When our normal is disrupted, our surroundings begin to feel weak. Foundations begin to rattle. Our lives become disoriented. As time goes on, we begin to lose sight of the one constant on our journey, Jesus. The fear is consuming, the worry draining, the doubt painful. Even in our darkest moments, when the last thread of hope has unraveled from our being, we must dwell on truth. We must remember, no matter what is happening around us, God is still sovereign. Today, let us dwell on the truth of Easter. The stone has been rolled away. The grave has been rendered powerless. Death has transformed to life. In our fear, He is still risen. In our worry, He is still victorious. In our doubt, He is still alive. When everything seems hopeless, the hope of Easter remains.
Thank you. Good morning, church. Last week we celebrated Resurrection Sunday together in a way that's kind of out of the norm for most of us, I'm sure. And as we gather around our televisions, our computer screens, our cell phones to worship the Lord, I'm certainly just like you felt it was a little bit different, a little bit weird. But did I worship the Lord? Yes. Did I celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ? Yes, I did. Did I hand out Easter eggs filled with money to the grandkids? Yes. But you know, it's not the same as fellowshipping and worshiping with a church family. And don't even get me started on those eggs, Portugal, and other items that we have for our sunrise breakfast following the sunrise service. You know, as the video you watched just a few moments ago reminded us, however, the hope of Easter is still alive. We still celebrate the resurrected Lord. And so today, even as we continue in our study of God's Word, it's our faith in God and our faith in Christ that can give us the strength that we need to continue on, even in these days of uncertainty. And so once we find ourselves worshiping and celebrating the Lord together, we can give Him honor and glory as well. Let's ask His blessing in prayer as we come into His Word today. Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for the opportunity we have to gather together to worship You and to celebrate and to be reminded of the hope that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. Certainly, Heavenly Father, these are unseen and untried times, but we come to You and ask for Your blessing, and we're here today to worship You in spirit and in truth. Use Your Word to teach and encourage us, we pray in Jesus' matchless name. Amen. For those of you that are listening by CD this morning, and you don't have the opportunity to hear the singing of our IOP group or to fellowship together in that way, let me just encourage you to use K-Love, other avenues of listening to God's music, those things that would encourage your heart as well. You know, it's our emphasis these past few weeks of that of hope during this difficult time. And the situation in which we find ourselves, how can we have continued hope in what the Lord Jesus Christ is doing in our nation, the world, and certainly as individuals, in communities, in the church. What is our hope based upon? If you have truly believed in the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you have hope, I have hope in Almighty God for what He has done and will do in my life. Our faith has to be based on someone or something. Whatever aspect of faith you may be talking about, certainly in the realm of Christianity, the object of our faith is the Lord Jesus Christ. And so as we gather together, we're reminded, even as we shared last week from the Apostle Paul there in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I would remind you of what he says in verse 14 and again in verse 17. He says this, "If Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty." It's vain, the Apostle Paul says. If Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Listen, Christians, let's continue to rejoice. Our hope is in the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. And as we think about that, as we fellowship together, and as we truly believe in the Word of God, the Bible, it gives us the encouragement that we need. In the last message we preached here in this church building, we emphasized some of the ways that our faith becomes weakened during our lifetime. And I would remind you of the example of Peter, found in the Gospel of Luke chapter 22. And if you have your Bibles, I'd encourage you to turn there. Luke chapter 22. And as you may recall, it's been a little bit over 72 hours, so you may have forgotten by now. But here in Luke chapter 22, verse 31, here's what we read. The Lord says, "Simon, Simon," that's Peter, "indeed Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat." And as you would recall, that word sift that's used there by the Lord Jesus Christ involves the idea of being shaken up violently, both up and down and sideways, back and forth. The idea of being shaken so much that as a result of that, it would cause you some internal turmoil. Picture for just a moment, if you could, back to the beginning of this calendar year, when many of us make those New Year's resolutions that we're going to lose weight. And think, if you would, for just a minute, of that liquid diet program that maybe you started. Remember how you would put that green gunk into the blender and all of those other items, and you would mix them up. Or maybe you put it into a little shaker container. And every morning you would just shake it violently so that the substances would become dissolved together. Now maybe you burn off more calories just by shaking than you did through the actual drink. But think about the violent movement of that and the shaking. The sifting that he mentions here, that Jesus talks about in the life of Peter. Think about it from a spiritual perspective for just a moment. And we would be reminded that sifting that Satan really desired in Peter's life to shake him to the core physically and certainly spiritually. So that his faith in God, his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, would come to the point, or bring him to the point, where he would almost walk away from the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember Peter's words in verse 33. He says this to the Lord Jesus Christ: "Lord, I am ready to go with you both to prison and to death." Remember Peter, he's the one who by faith walked on the water to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the one who in proclaiming of Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 16, verse 16, he says this: "Thou art the Christ, the Son of God." And yet, as we know, in the midst of all of these trials of the Lord Jesus Christ, he denied even knew the Lord Jesus. His faith became weakened in the heat of the battle. But you know, praise God that even though his faith was eclipsed for a small moment in time, Peter was delivered from the shuddering of his faith by Almighty God. And then the Lord Jesus Christ, and again, by God's strength and by his grace, he became the pillar of faith that God would later use to begin the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ to the early church. Right now, our faith is being tested. Your faith is being tested. The demands on our lives to live in separation from other people, to see jobs disappearing, even though we would pray that they would come back quickly. To see family members or our friends succumb to the physical struggles of this virus. And sadly, even as I did yesterday, to share with a family whose loved one passed away as a result of this virus. It's heartbreaking. But I would pray that even as we examine the scriptures today, that your faith would not be shaken, that your faith would continue to grow as a result of what Jesus does in our life. The question for us today, my friends, is this: what is it about my faith that keeps demanding even greater testing of us? What is it in my faith? Because sometimes it seems that even though as I would come through one struggle in life and I'm feeling pretty good and things are going well, then another aspect of trial or testing comes along in my life. I would remind you, even as we would perhaps ask, why is my faith being tested, or what is God doing? I would remind you what James says in James chapter 1, beginning in verse 2. This is a passage that's familiar to most of us, but James says this: "My brethren, count it all joy." Now that seems kind of strange, especially in the circumstance of which we live now, but notice the reason for that joy. He goes on to say, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing or the trying of your faith produces patience." That word patience there is the idea of endurance or perseverance, if you would, in the faith. He says, "Knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience or endurance or perseverance, but let patience have its perfect work in you," he says, "so that you may be perfect," the word there, mature, "so that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing." There are a lot of examples in Scripture of God maturing people's faith throughout the course of their life. And what I'd like to do this morning is to examine the life of one of these men, the man Abraham, and think about the demands on faith in his life. And then perhaps, Lord willing, in the next week, to be able to share another example of God demanding a little bit more of our faith and how that affects us in our daily walk. How does Abraham's faith, or what are the demands, if you would, on Abraham's faith? Turn with me, if you would, in the Old Testament to the book of Genesis, chapter 12. Beginning in Genesis chapter 12, we start to see the outlining of the events that take place in Abraham's life. And as you would think about that, and as you would look at the scriptures, by the time we're getting to these passages and this time in Abraham's life, he's about 100 years of age. He had endured a lifetime of testing and difficulties. I would remind you of where it began here in Genesis chapter 12, just a few years before that 100 time span. But here in Genesis chapter 12, the process of faith testing begins with Abraham. Here's what the scriptures say. It says, "The Lord says to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you." That would be difficult. He says, "I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse him who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." When we first read of Abraham here in this passage, he's asked to move to an unknown location, someplace completely different from where he'd been his entire life, where he had begun to prosper in life. Notice verse 4. After God says this to Abraham, "So Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken to him." Abraham did what God told him to do. By faith, he left where he was comfortable. And as you would continue to read on throughout chapter 12, chapter 13, chapter 14, as you think about all of the trials and the things that took place in Abraham's life, he continued to be faithful to Almighty God. I would take you over to chapter 15. And notice in chapter 15 of Genesis, in the first few verses, Abraham has a conversation with God. In the course of that conversation, he reminds God, if you would, about the fact that he said he would bless him with a great family. Even if you remember the usage of the idea of the stars of the sky or the sand in the, on the seashore. And Abraham, in this conversation, speaks about not having a son. Look again in verse 5. Then God brings him out and he again says to him, "Look now toward heaven. Count the stars if you're able to number them." And he said to him, God says to Abraham, "So shall your descendants be." Notice Abraham's response in verse 6. And he believed in the Lord, and he, God, counted it to him for righteousness. Time after time, Abraham puts his faith in God, his trust in God. And if you go over to chapter 18, verse 19, you're reminded that in the course of God speaking of Abraham, he just simply says that he was considered righteous in his eyes because he trusted God. Now, in the events of history, Abraham's getting older. And as I said earlier, now he's about 100 years of age and his son Isaac is born. Abraham's now living out his retirement. He's sitting on the porch on his rocking chair, just watching the sunsets every night. And as a result of what's going on, you would think that God would say, "Well, you know, I've tested you, Abraham, and I've proved you righteous. Just kind of enjoy the rest of your life." But look what happens in chapter 22. Turn over to Genesis chapter 22. It says in verse 1, "It came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham. And Abraham says, here I am." After all of this time of testing and Abraham proving himself to God himself, another test comes his way. He's then throughout the course of chapter 22, and I would encourage you to read these events yourself even this week. He takes his son, his only son, to an isolated mountain, and there, as God had commanded him, he is to sacrifice him to the Lord. That would certainly end the promise of God. Think about this event in his life for just a moment. As you would read this account here in Genesis chapter 22, Abraham doesn't share anything with the men who accompanied him. He certainly doesn't share anything about what's going to take place with his son. He simply says God will provide the sacrifice, all the while knowing that the sacrifice was his very son. By faith, Abraham just believed God, and he does what God asks. And when the event unfolds, and God provides the lamb sacrifice in place of Isaac, no one knows about that but Abraham and Isaac. The promise is again revealed in chapter 22, verses 16 through 18. And here's what we read. The angel speaking to Abraham says, "By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this thing, because you went to sacrifice your son as I have asked, and you have not withheld your son, your only son." Here's the promise. "Blessing, I will bless you. Multiplying, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is on the seashore. And your descendants shall possess the gate of their enemies. In your seed, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed." Why? "Because you have obeyed my voice." Again, that promise by God to Abraham. And as you would read, you don't read anything of him sharing it. Abraham simply goes back home and he lives out his faith. Now, I don't want you to notice what's said of Abraham later on in the scriptures in the book of Hebrews. And in Hebrews chapter 11, this is known as the faith chapter. Many of those that are shared the examples of faith in their life. Notice what it says about Abraham. Hebrews chapter 11, beginning in verse 17. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. You should note the similarity of the phrase there in speaking of God giving his only begotten son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins, even as we have spoken about and talked about these last few weeks. He says, "Even he who offered up his only begotten son, Abraham, of whom it was said, 'In Isaac your seed shall be called.'" Notice Abraham concluding that God was able to raise him up, to even raise Isaac up from the dead, from which he also received in him a figurative sense. Again, speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ. Understanding Abraham's faith. And yet when Abraham dies, he has not seen the promise of God fulfilled. His family doesn't grow to the numbers that are spoken of in this promise until long after Abraham has died. What can we learn from the faith of Abraham? Very simply, friends, we simply cannot. Right now, we cannot know how God is maturing our faith in this national crisis. But I would share with you, he is maturing our faith. He is using this to make us stronger in our faith to him. Don't run from God. Turn to him for the strengthening of your faith. Earlier in the message, I reminded us of Peter's trials. There in Luke chapter 22, in the trial of the Lord Jesus Christ, I should say, and how Peter's faith was sifted even to the point where he almost took his eyes off of the Lord Jesus Christ. And in Luke chapter 22, verse 32, listen to the words of Jesus to Peter. In the midst of his conversation, he says this, "Peter, I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. And when you have," not when you will, "when you have returned to me, then strengthen your brethren." We will never reach a point in our lives, friends, when the Lord Jesus Christ is not there to help us make it through the challenges of life. God's promise to Peter and to us is shared again in the book of Hebrews chapter 13, where we read in verses 5 and 6, "I will never leave you nor forsake you, so that we may boldly say, 'The Lord is my helper. I will not fear. God wants us to draw closer to Him. Why? So that He could shape our lives. So that as our faith is strengthened, we become more valuable in our work and ministry for the Lord Jesus Christ. That the essence of faith in the midst of our trials, even today, is just being willing to travel like Abraham did in the early parts of his life, to just move on, to go to another place where God was going to use him. For us to allow the Lord to lead us in our lives without knowing where he's going to take us. We don't know the future of the church and the concentration of worshiping together. But we do know this, that our faith as it is strengthened and as God continues to work in our lives, he will then be glorified in all that we do. Friends, listen, the faith walk of Abraham, the faith example of the life of Abraham, the faith walk that we have, it begins by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. And the scriptures say that as we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and as the Bible teaches us that we will have eternal life, then the Lord will begin to work in our lives, and he'll begin to use us for his glory. He'll begin to not only encourage us, but help us through this faithful walk with him. Our prayer and desire for you as God's church is that God's presence and his strength during this trying time would cause our faith in him to be stronger, to be more mature, as James says. God knows the end. Our governors don't know the end. President Trump doesn't know the end. God knows the end of not only this circumstance, but every situation in our lives. Let's continue to be faithful, believing, even as Abraham did, that God has his best for our lives. He's with us. He gives us hope. And by faith, we trust the Lord Jesus Christ. May his word be an encouragement as we think about how Abraham's faith was tested and tried. And even in the ages of being older, God still tested and used him for his glory. May that also be said of us as the church of Almighty God. Father, I pray that our faith would continue to be strengthened, that we would learn not only from the example of Abraham and others in Scripture, but Father God, that you would encourage us and strengthen us. Give our faith that which is needed to be stronger during this time. We call upon you in your presence to teach us, to help us to grow, to help us to be stronger in our faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. Might you be glorified and praised in our lives. This week we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We are still the church. We continue to worship the Lord. Let me encourage you, check on one another, call folks, offer to help as the need arises. When you call them up, spend some time reading God's word together. Pray with other people. I would encourage you throughout the week to check out the Facebook page of our church and to be encouraged by the devotional studies that Pastor Barry is sharing with us every day. Call upon the Lord. Call upon one another for strength and encouraging. Husbands and wives, have devotions together. It'll help ease some of the tensions that you have throughout the day. Do the same with your children and encourage them in the teachings and the reading of God's word. Until we meet again, remember this, as the message of the closing video we share, we are still the church. The church is God's people. Might we be strengthened in our faith and used for God's glory. God bless, and the Lord give you a great week.